Hello everybody, welcome you all. In today's class, I will be discussing Karl Marx. As you know it, Karl Marx was a great philosopher of Germany. His lifespan was 1818 to 1883. He was such a German thinker who contributed immensely to the field of economics, history, sociology, as well as political science. In your syllabus prescribed by UPSC, four contributions of Karl Marx have been mentioned, namely the theory of class and class struggle, second, theory of alienation, third, dialectical or historical materialism, and fourth one, that is mode of production. But before making a detailed discussion related to Karl Marx's contribution to sociology, I think it is very much right on my part just to tell you what are the basic philosophy of Karl Marx, because all the four contributions of Karl Marx have a connection with the basic philosophy of Karl Marx. So what are the basic philosophies that I will be discussing first? There are six important basic philosophies or approaches of Karl Marx. What are they? First is conflict theory. What is conflict theory? I have already discussed earlier. In sociology, there are two diametrically opposite perspectives or approaches. One is functional perspective and its opposite is conflict perspective. Functional perspective highlights the positive contributions of different elements of society. On the contrary, conflict theory or conflict perspective highlights the negative contribution of different elements of society. So Marx's philosophy is conflict perspective. What is that? If you ask a question to Karl Marx, what is the role of religion? Karl Marx will highlight the negative contribution of religion. He would tell you the fact how by using the name of religion, a man is exploiting a woman, a Brahmin is exploiting a Dalit, a black is exploited by a white, and an industrialist is exploiting also industrial worker by taking the name of religion. So religion has a negative contribution. So if you ask the contribution of any element in present capitalist system, Karl Marx will highlight its negative contribution. That's the reason his approach is called conflict theory or conflict perspective. Then second most important philosophy of Karl Marx is economic determinism. What is that economic determinism? This economic determinism is also called superstructure relationship. What is that substructure and superstructure relationship? Just make a derivation. Economic derivation of economic determinism. What is that? Economic plus determine plus ism, that is called economic determinism. What is economics? Economics is the study of a human being, how human being is earning money or spending money. That is the primary concern of economics. So economics is primarily concerned with money or finance. And determine plus ism means philosophy. So economic determinism promotes the idea that in a society there are different branches, there are different areas, like political areas, economic areas, religious areas, educational areas, bureaucratic areas. So in a society there are different aspects of life, And out of different aspects of life, like educational aspect, religious aspect, political aspect, bureaucratic aspect, etc., the most important aspect of social life is economic aspect. Exactly in that way, in an individual's life, there are different dimensions of life, that is religious dimension, political dimension, educational dimension, judicial dimension, and others. Out of different dimensions of life of an individual, the economic dimension of life is very, very important. Economic determinism promotes the idea that a person can become successful in any sphere of life if he is having consolidated economic power or financial power. For example, Karl Marx will say you that the candidate who is having good economic position, he or his father, or she or her father and mother, if a candidate's father and mother are having good financial position, then the candidate is having higher possibility of becoming successful in competitive examination like IAS. Karl Marx will never say that a competition is made between two unequal people. Karl Marx should say, if there are two candidates, both of them are having equal talent and equal potential, but one is from poverty-stricken background and another is from affluent background, and a competition is made between two candidates of equal potential and talent, then the candidate who is having talent as well as good financial power, that candidate is having higher possibility of becoming successful in IAS examination. Take another example, politics. Suppose there are two candidates contesting for becoming MP in a parliamentary constituency. Both of them are having equal ability in the matter of managing human resource, means both of them are good orator. Both of them are skilled in influencing the voters. But out of these two candidates, one is having billions of rupees and another candidate is not having money. So in this case, if a competition in politics is made between two candidates of equal potential but unequal monetary power, in that case, the candidate having consolidated financial power is having higher possibility of becoming successful in the election, means winning the election and getting elected as an MP. So in this way, Karl Marx is of the opinion that economic life or economic aspect of life is the most important aspect of life. Rest of the aspects of life, they are depending upon economic aspect. So in this way, Karl Marx says, economic power is the substructure. Substructure means foundation. But politics, religion, education, judiciary, bureaucracy, they are the superstructure. They have been erected on the foundation of economy. You know, while you construct a building, first you construct the foundation. If the foundation is strong, then building will be very strong. If the foundation is weak, building will be collapsed. Exactly in that way. You see, but buildings, nobody would be able to see the foundation, but foundation gives strength to the building. Exactly in that way, a person who is having good monetary power, his possibility of contesting election and winning election is higher. A candidate who is having good monetary power, if he prepares for civil service, his possibility or her possibility of becoming successful in civil service examination is higher. If two persons are fighting a case in court of law, and the candidate who is having good monetary power, person who is having good monetary power, he can hire the best of the best lawyer of the country and engage him on behalf of him, and in this way he can get justice also from the court of law. So in this way, whether you become successful in politics or not, whether would become successful in matter of fighting a case in court of law and getting justice or not, whether you would become successful in the matter of getting permission from the collector in matter of doing certain things or not, everything is decided and determined by your monetary power. Therefore, monetary power or economic power is invisible, but it is the foundation. Success in other spheres of life depends on your monetary power. Therefore, money or economy constitutes the substructure, that is foundation, but politics, religion, education, judiciary, bureaucracy, they constitute the superstructure. This is called economic determinism. Therefore, in single sentence, I can say economic determinism promotes the idea that success in different spheres of life depends on the consolidated financial power of a person.